15.1 talks about selective breeding. So if we think about it, you might ask, where does popcorn come from? Would you be surprised to learn that popcorn is one of the earliest examples of human efforts to select and improve living organisms for our benefit? Well, corn, as we know it, was domesticated at least 6,000 years ago by Native Americans living in Mexico. A tiny kernel of popcorn was found in a cave in New Mexico that was more than 5,000 years old. That's pretty wild. It says something about how long popcorn can last. So, what is selective breeding used for? Well, humans use selective breeding, which takes advantage of naturally occurring genetic variation to pass the wanted traits on to the next generation of organisms. So the difference among breeds of dogs are great. So where did these differences come from? Humans use selective breeding to produce animals with certain desired traits. Selective breeding allows only those animals with wanted characteristics to produce the next generation. So for thousands of years, we've produced new varieties of cultivated plants and nearly all domestic animals by selectively breeding for particular traits. Native Americans selectively bred teosinte. Am I saying that right? Teosinte. Yeah, I guess we're going to go with that. A wild grass native to central Mexico to produce corn as far more productive and a nutritious plant. Corn is now one of the world's most important crops. So there are two methods of selective breeding: hybridization and inbreeding. Hybridization. An American botanist, Luther Burbank, developed more than 800 varieties of plants using selective breeding methods. And one method used was hybridization, which is the crossing dissimilar individuals to bring together the best of both organisms. Hybrids. The individuals produced by such crosses are often hardier than either of their parents are. So many of Burbank's hybrid crosses combine the disease resistance of one plant with the food producing capacity of another. And the result was a new line of plants that had the traits farmers needed to increase food production. July Alberta peaches, for example, are among Burbank's most successful varieties. So to maintain desirable characteristics in the line of organisms, breeders often use inbreeding, the continued breeding of individuals with similar characteristics. The many breeds of dogs are maintained using inbreeding, ensuring that the characteristics that make each breed unique are preserved. And although inbreeding is useful in preserving, I'm going to start laughing now that I messed up. Okay. Although inbreeding is useful in preserving certain traits, it can be risky. So most of the members of a breed are genetically similar, which increases the chance that a cross between two individuals will bring together two recessive alleles for a genetic defect. So how do people increase genetic variation? Well, breeders can increase the genetic variation in a population by introducing mutations, which are the ultimate source of biological diversity. And when scientists manipulate the genetic makeup of an organism, they're using biotechnology. And that is the application of a technological process, invention, or method to living organisms. So selective breeding is one form of biotechnology important in agriculture and medicine, but there are others. So mutations can occur spontaneously, but breeders can increase the mutation rate of an organism by using radiation or chemicals. So many mutations are harmful to the organism, but breeders can often produce a few mutants, individuals with mutations with useful characteristics that are not found in the original population. So for example, scientists have developed hundreds of useful mutant bacterial strains by treating bacteria with radiation or chemicals. And certain strains of oil-digesting bacteria are effective for cleanup used in the cleanup of oil spills, and scientists are currently working to produce bacteria that can clean up radioactive substances and metal pollution in the environment. So, drugs that prevent the separation of chromosomes during meiosis are very useful in plant breeding. These drugs can produce cells that have many times the normal number of chromosomes. So plants grown in these cells are called polyploid because they have many sets of chromosomes. And polyploidy is usually fatal in animals, but plants are much better at tolerating extra sets of chromosomes. So, polyploid plants. Polyploidy can quickly produce new species of plants that are larger and stronger than their diploid relatives. And a number of important crop plants include bananas, which have been produced in this way. So, there's a chart when you look at it in your text that will show the domestic cat, the peanut, the sugar cane, the banana, and cotton, and you will be able to see on the little chart that they have the probable ancestral haploid number, their chromosome number, and the ploidy level on each of those. And that's it for this section.